Thank you, Glenda. I don't know exactly who you were pointing at back there. Not going to name any names. Not going to name any names, Kelly. I'm not going to do it. Not going to do it. Barbara Brown Taylor tells a story about a very capable woman who went on a journey. And this woman had been successful in many things she tried. Not all of them, but most things. And yet, as much as she accomplished, she still believed there was more to life than she had experienced. And so she set out to discover the meaning of life. First, she read everything she could get her hands on: history, philosophy, psychology, religion. And while she became a very well-read person, nothing she read gave her the answer that she was looking for. She found other smart people and asked them about the meaning of life. But while their discussions were long and lively, no two of them agreed on the same thing, and so still she had no answer. Finally, she put all of her belongings in storage and set off on a journey in the search of the meaning of life. She went to South America. She went to India. Everywhere she went, people told her they did not know the meaning of life. But the wisest among them told her that they had heard of a man who did, only they weren't sure where he lived. She asked about him in every country on earth until finally, deep in the Himalayas, someone told her how to reach his house, a tiny little hut perched on the side of a mountain just below the tree line. And so she set out. She climbed and climbed to reach his front door. When she finally got there with knuckles so cold they hardly worked, she knocked. There stood a wrinkled old man with kind eyes. She thought she would die of happiness. "I have come halfway around the world to ask you one question," she said, gasping for breath. "What is the meaning of life?" The man paused for a moment and then said, "Please come in and have some tea." "No," she said. "I mean, no, thank you. I didn't come all this way for tea. I came for an answer. Won't you tell me, please, what is the meaning of life?" This time, the man just made a statement: "We shall have tea." So she gave up and came inside. While he was brewing the tea, she caught her breath and began telling him about all the books that she had read, all of the people that she had met, all the places that she had been. The old man listened, which was just as well, since his visitor did not leave any room for him to reply. And as she talked, he placed a fragile teacup in her hand. And then he began to pour the tea. She was so busy talking that she did not notice when the teacup was full. So the old man just kept pouring until the tea ran over the sides of the cup and spilled onto her hands and onto the floor in a steaming waterfall. "What are you doing?" she yelled when the tea burned her hand. "It's full. Can't you see that? Stop. There's no more room." "Just so," the old man said to her. "You have come here wanting something from me, but what am I to do? There is no more room in your cup. Come back when it is empty, and then we will talk." Meanwhile, several thousand miles to the west, a man of the Pharisees, a ruler of the Jews named Nicodemus, comes to Jesus by night. Right off the bat, Nicodemus starts spouting off what he knows. "Rabbi," he says, "we all know that God has sent you to teach us. Your miraculous signs are evidence that God is with you." Now, if a well-educated, highly respected man like Nicodemus throws that kind of compliment my direction, my head would puff up so fast it might explode. Jesus, however, isn't particularly impressed. "Nicodemus, you are a well-educated man, but to experience the kingdom of God isn't about what you know. If you want to experience the kingdom of God, you are going to have to forget that you are a wise old scholar and be born again." Now let me stop and ask you a question for a moment. For how many of you in the day and the time in which you grow up in the church in which you have a spiritual heritage at that age, do you remember a time when those words were highly familiar? Show of hands. Born again. Now, in the church that I grew up in as a child, that's what we describe the experience of becoming a Christian, this overwhelming emotional experience of coming to terms with God's grace and our need for it. Being born again, at least in my own heritage, was synonymous with being a Christian. But when Jesus first utters these words centuries ago, he wasn't describing some emotional experience that led to conversion and church membership. He was describing a particular challenge for a particular human being. Nicodemus, a man of the Pharisees, a ruler of the Jews, came looking for some answers to his questions. For most of his life, he had dedicated himself to the pursuit of truth, and over a lifetime, he had acquired an impressive amount of information, so much so that he was a leader among his people. And yet, now here is Jesus telling him, in essence, that all of his hard work, all of his search for knowledge amounted to very little. He was going to have to start over. An old dog is going to have to learn new tricks. Not exactly the best news in the world, but if that's all that Jesus had said, then maybe Nicodemus could have gone along with it. I mean, he had dedicated his entire life to acquiring wisdom and knowledge. What did it matter if the search was just going to take a little longer, more facts to memorize, more wisdom to gain? Then Jesus starts talking about the wind, how it blows where it will, and how you can't make it blow the way you want it to blow. And neither, says Jesus, can you explain, can you manufacture being born again? The Holy Spirit does it. It's not something that you can just acquire. Nicodemus came to ask Jesus a question, but Jesus didn't cooperate because it was the wrong question. Nicodemus came to ask how he could acquire the meaning of life. Jesus just poured tea all over his hands. He said, in effect, that Nicodemus already had gallons of answers available to him. What he really needed was a life that was open enough to be filled from above. Anyone here ever heard of a man named Steve Sasson? That name ring any bells? If you're a photography buff, maybe that name might mean something to you. In 1975, Steve Sasson invented the digital camera. He worked for a company that was the preeminent company in film and cameras. In 1975, if you owned a camera or if you bought film, there was a 90% chance that this camera was made or the film was made by the Kodak Corporation. You remember those little yellow boxes of film with the red logo on them that we all used to buy? Well, Steve Sasson had been working on this new technology that would just bypass the film and just take the picture and download it as ones and zeros and then being able to reproduce it. The only problem was the executives of the Kodak Corporation said to themselves, we're not just in the camera business, we're in the film business. Why would we want to promote something that would take away half of our profits? And so they put it on a shelf. And it sat there for years while other companies came along, Sony, Nikon, Canon. After worship this morning, George Gates came to me and said, George grew up in Rochester, New York, where Kodak is based. He said, Matt, that's not the full story. Not only did the Kodak Corporation pass on the digital camera, a few years earlier than that, they had the patent to some mimeograph technology, and they decided it didn't really fit with their business model, and so the man who worked on it left the company and started another company called Xerox. don't know if it was the same leadership that led Kodak through both of those missed opportunities, but in 2012, Kodak filed for Chapter 11 bankruptcy. And it's easy, isn't it, in hindsight, to look back and to realize that a company like Kodak missed out on what turned out to be a fantastic discovery. But the truth is, most of us have fallen in that trap at some point or another. So certain of who we know that it's hard to comprehend that something completely outside our experience could be even better. Our hands so tightly wrapped around what we have, we don't have room for the blessing that God has in store for us. Jesus starts talking about the wind and being born again. Nicodemus protested that he didn't know what Jesus was talking about. Jesus responds, "If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things?" Part of the problem, I think, was the difference between what Jesus meant when he said believe and what Nicodemus meant by the same word. On one level, to believe means simply to accept what someone says is true, usually on the basis of some evidence. Somebody shows you a picture of himself mountain climbing, tells you it can be done, and you say, "Okay, I believe you." You accept the proposition. You give your intellectual assent, but it doesn't interfere with the way you live your life because it is all in your head. But there is another level of belief when that person says, "Are you ready to climb with me? Are you ready to go to the top?" Instead of showing you the pictures, he has invited you to put your life in his hands. As he checks the knots on your harness and runs your safety line through the carabiner around his own waist, he assures you that everything will be all right. And suddenly you realize you're about to be hundreds of feet in the air, and the person that you're climbing with has their life in your hands. The proper response at that point is not, "I believe you," but "I believe in you," because you are way past anything like intellectual assent. At that point, it's all about the relationship. You are trusting him with your life. Nicodemus was halfway there. He came by night to interview the new teacher in town. He knew that Jesus was good. He had checked his references, but he wanted a little bit more information. He wanted to see his accident reports, check out the insurance coverage. He wanted to handle the equipment for himself, maybe try it on for size. He wanted the teacher to say something that would take away his doubts and make it easier for him to say yes. Jesus doesn't cooperate. "Believe in me." That was Jesus' dare to Nicodemus. "Turn your cup upside down. Turn your mind inside out. Step out into the air. Ride the wind. Be born again." "How can this be?" asks Nicodemus. Those are his last words in this passage, which makes him a kind of patron saint for all of those who get stuck at the foot of the mountain looking up without the faintest idea of how to begin. We've all been there, haven't we? Some of us, maybe most of us, are there to some extent. Maybe even at this very moment. You don't have to be a wise old man like Nicodemus to be holding on to a lifetime of doing it your own way. You don't have to be wealthy for your life to be so full that you've got no room for a new blessing. And it wasn't just non-Christians that Jesus was telling that they needed to be born again. All of us, at some point or another, have been where Nicodemus was. In these 40 days between Ash Wednesday and the cross, we are invited to follow Jesus. truth is, the place where Jesus is headed is the cross. But it's not just the moment of the cross itself. Even the journey is supposed to prepare us for the newness of life that's going to come on the other side of it. The invitation is for us to be buried with Christ so that we might rise to walk in newness of life. And the question that I want to invite you to ask this morning, to wrestle with a little bit in this season that we're getting closer and closer to the cross, is what needs to die in you? What needs to be buried in you so that you can rise to walk in newness of life? For Nicodemus, what needed to die was his own sense that he had most of it all figured out. Instead, to be willing to start over and start fresh and let the Holy Spirit take him in new directions, to experience new things, to be pushed and challenged and shaped, and ultimately to set his own feet on the journey towards the cross, following Jesus. I don't know about you, but I empathize with him. Nicodemus is he's a good guy. You don't hear stories of all of the other religious leaders of that day coming to talk to Jesus. Nicodemus is the only one who does it like that. He sees something. He senses that there is something going on that he needs to pay attention to, but the crux of the problem, the challenge in front of him, was he just going to put one little toe in the water and dip it a little, just enough? Or is he going to dive all the way in? Nicodemus isn't a guy who's struggling with some terrible sin. He's just a guy who's struggling with the sense that he's been doing it for a long time and he's not entirely certain he's ready to try it a new way or not. How can this be? I'm Nicodemus. Maybe you are too. All of us have a little bit of pride that needs to be buried with Christ so that we can be raised to walk in newness of life. So if that's you, you think you're too old to learn something new, if you're so used to leading others that you haven't been led in a while, if you're stuck in the same place spiritually that you've been for 5 years or 10 years or 20, then the good news is we actually do have a great example to follow in our text this morning. There, sitting next to that wise old scholar, sits a young man in his 30s who also just happens to be the Son of God. A little bit later in this text, John will tell us, "For God so loved the world that whosoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him." There sits Jesus, as old as time, and yet he was born into the world to show us that even God becomes a baby sometimes. And he was born into the world to die on the cross so that our old, stale ways of living might be buried with him and we might be raised to walk in newness of life with him. Whoever believes in him, whoever believes in him, won't perish, but instead will experience eternal life. Listen close, all of us Nicodemuses. It's not about what you know and where you've been. It's about who you know and where he is taking you. Here is how, Jesus says. Watch me. Put your hand here. Now bring up your foot. Don't think about it too hard. Just do as I do. Believe me. Believe in me. And when we get to the top of the mountain, we will have tea. Would you pray with me? Father, create in us a hunger for renewal. A hunger to experience more of what you have already lavished upon us so richly. Help us not to be satisfied with a chapter of our story that happened a month ago or a year ago or a decade ago or half a lifetime ago. But help us to be hungry for more. Even if, God, that means that to get it, we're going to have to go somewhere we've never been and try something we've never tried. Love somebody that's hard to love. Whatever that might look like, God, help us not just to believe Jesus, but to believe in Him and go where He's taking us. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.